Now that Pat and Pat are seated, we can begin. So I want to welcome everyone, invite you to just take a breath while I begin with a spiritual mind treatment. So let us just know and recognize together that this is truly a spiritual universe, that we are all engaged in this thing called life, that we are one with life, and life is one with us. We live and have our being in spirit, and spirit lives through us, for us, as us, and with us. Therefore, everything is essentially an act of good unfolding. But we are at choice. We are free to think our own thoughts. And knowing this, and understanding that spirit responds to our thoughts, I know, I claim, and I declare that this morning's service is something wonderful unfolding, that our lives today are something wonderful unfolding, that this Labor Day weekend, a time of celebration, relaxation, and enjoyment, is something wonderful unfolding, that there is good for each of us. I claim health, prosperity, and joy on behalf of each person here and everyone with whom we are connected and with whom they are connected. I understand we are all connected. That is the nature of life. And so I know that there is good for us all, just like the stars and the sun shine upon us all. We're all perfect, whole, and complete in our spiritual essence. And so I give thanks for our ability to come together and know this and celebrate this right here, right now. And I invite you to know this with me, with a heart full of gratitude, by saying together with me, and so it is. Thank you.
Electronic waves are interesting today.
Better.
I hope you all thought that was worth. Wait, am I on? Is my microphone on?
Yes, you're dead, yeah.
No. I can hear you. Yes?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Okay. So we are so lucky because we had scheduled Michael Paul to play today, and he had a little surgery, and I think he's doing well, and so everything's good. And Jim was able to get James Higgins to play today. And so we're so blessed to have you with us. Now we're going to have a little bit of running back and forth, and that has to do with the connections in the back. So, can you hear me right now?
You could be a little louder.
Let me just run over the back.
They're always very considerate of me.
Well, that's good.
Because I have a part of you.
Oh, beautiful.
Wow.
Perfect time. Thank you, Maddie. Yay.
Thank you.
So, it's a beautiful day, isn't it?
It is.
So, I'm Reverend Kate, and it's really my great joy to welcome everyone today to the Center for Spiritual Living Carlsbad, where we understand that there is a power for good in the universe greater than we are, and that we can use it. So what we'd like to do to begin with is have our candle lighting. And I need a volunteer. Susan, wonderful.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you, Susan. So the whole idea of lighting these candles is just to remind ourselves of the underlying spirit of life and the divine unity of all. So first, we light a candle for life. Life is everywhere present, flowing through each and every one of us. There is only one life. That life is God's life. That life is our life now. So please affirm with me, I am life. We light a candle for love. The birth of love happens within each one of us every time we make room for the Christ consciousness in our hearts and recognize our unity. We are points of love within the heart of God. So please affirm with me, I am love. We light a candle for light. The light of God is the presence and the power, and we are always walking in the light. We radiate the light of God wherever we are. So please affirm with me, I am light. We light a candle for beauty. We are made in the likeness and image of God. We are each whole, complete, and beautiful just as we are. We accept the beauty of God's perfection as our perfection now. Please affirm with me, I am beauty. We light a candle for joy. Joy is the very nature of spirit and the true essence of each of us. We celebrate the joy of our own rebirth in the God's consciousness. We each bring joy to the world. So please affirm with me, I am joy. And we light a candle for peace. Today and every day, we open our hearts to peace. We are each a center of peace in our world. So please affirm with me, I am peace. And finally, I want to invite you to take a moment and recognize your own inner light that is always shining within as we each honor our own metaphysical path of wholeness, oneness, and mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. Thank you, Susan. So I just have a few announcements to share. Well, first, obviously, I want to welcome everyone, and especially anyone visiting for the first time. So make yourselves at home, stay for fellowship, and sign the guest book. And today is birthday Sunday, so it's day for cake. So does anyone have a September birthday?
No, but we're never that many.
Well, I just had my birthday 2 days ago.
Oh.
So we can still sing happy birthday to me.
Yeah.
James is going to help us out with that. So we'll just sing that together.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear
everybody.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you all, and happy birthday to everyone that we got to have a September birthday, too. So, anyway, we do have cake, so stay for that. And a lot of other goodies, too. So the other thing that's really important is I want to remind everyone that today and every Sunday, we offer spiritual mind treatment, either in person after our service, and today we have myself, Reverend Maureen, Practitioner Robert, Practitioner Larry, available if you want a spoken treatment. Or please remember to write out a prayer request and put it in the box in the lobby, and then our whole prayer team receives that, and we do treatment during the week. Right. And then the other thing I wanted to just remind everyone, last week we decided we would extend this program, our unexpected income program, for another month. So even though the flyer says through September 15th, it's going to be through October 15th. If you didn't get a chance to sign up for it, we do have information on the program available. And it's very simple. What we do is basically, this is a spiritual practice to help us build our faith. So each individual is asked to read prayer treatment every day, but also know that our prayer team is also doing treatment for all the participants. And the idea is just to know and open our minds to accepting greater abundance and prosperity in our lives. We do ask that you tithe 10% of unexpected income only. This doesn't necessarily have to do with your expected or ordinary income, although we really appreciate how many people do tithe on that for our center. But this is just for this program, and we kind of keep track of how much has been received, you know, multiply that times 10, and so it's kind of fun. And today, I believe that Jim would like to share a demonstration that he has had.
Thank you, Reverend Kate. This is an interesting demonstration. And I wrote it down to make sure I don't forget anything, because I'm sort of at that age. I should not claim that for myself, because really I'm only 40 years old. But anyway, about 3 weeks ago, I started having loss of signal connection issues with my DirecTV satellite service. And I've been really busy, and I kept putting it off, and it was working when I needed it most of the time. Anyway, last Monday, it got to the point where it would not work at all. So I called the DirecTV, my satellite service, talked to a tech who came out and fixed the issue in a timely manner, which was really great. The customer service person said because I was so patient, they wanted to thank me for being a good customer. So they decided to reduce my monthly bill, $64, for the next 12 months. It's a $768 gift. You multiply that out. A perfect example of unexpected income and a demonstration of I plugged my book, Thank You God, that technique that I've been saying over the last 25 years. The daily affirmation that has to do with money says, thank you, God, that the money that flows to me now continues to increase at the rate of 30% per year from channels known and unknown. DirecTV is definitely unknown.
Yeah.
You would agree with that, right? Okay. And my last thing, since I'm promoting it, is I gift the book to the center. So if you'd like a copy and you don't have one yet, or you want to get one to a friend, see Jan in the back and she'll give you a free copy.
Thank you.
Oh, one last thing. On Thursday, I won $10 at Bunkle. So Jan's going to find an extra buck in the blue thing.
So... we know. Oh,
Susan, I have a demonstration.
Do you want to stand up and share?
Yes. I made an extra $100 for dog sitting, and I got a lot of exercise doing it. I have to walk the dog twice a day. I call it Grandma Boot Camp.
That's wonderful. So, yes. Susan just shared an extra $100 that she received. Is that right?
It'll be 10% of that.
Yeah. No, I understand. You shared with us verbally that you received $100. Yeah. No, I mean, the whole idea is to open. So that's wonderful. And thank you for sharing. Because as we share, we're sharing our demonstrations, and it helps us all build faith and understanding that treatment works. It really does. The other thing I wanted to announce is we have some new copies of the Science of Mind magazine available in the bookstore, and this is for the September and October issue. You always have the opportunity to subscribe either for the magazine, but they also offer now an online subscription, which is really nice too. So, you all know, it's very obvious that this is a community-based spiritual center, and everything we do depends on our volunteers. And so we have great volunteers today. First, let's thank Maddie for the flowers. Oh, Ruthanne for the flowers. Let's thank Ruthanne for the flowers. Let's thank Maddie for sharing the flowers. Yeah. Help all around. I want to thank Jan Green for being our greeter today. And also bring some treats, and I brought the cake, so thank you all for singing to me. So, I want to thank Jim for being our video recorder. Thank you, Jim. And I want to thank my son, Dave, for doing the setup, and of course, Jan for doing what she does in the bookstore and minding, doing a little dog sitting this morning.
Yes.
The dog. Oh,
I just wanted to say I have a basket of abundance in the way of tomatoes.
Oh, that's great. So Pat has harvested in her garden and there are tomatoes to take home. So it's not just money. Abundance comes in all forms.
How many tomatoes do you want?
Yeah. I love tomatoes, but thank you for sharing. Pat.
Thank you for receiving.
So today, let's move on to the group reading inside your program. If you want to just find that, then we can read it together. Ready? God is all, both visible and invisible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect love and perfect abundance. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect abundance. And now, let's turn over to James for a group song. I think some of you have words. Is it, how could, oh.
Stand. Would you like to stand?
Water.
It's from Peace That Conquers by Holmes, and it was written in 1954, November 7th. 2 days away from my birthday. You and I know that no matter how confused we are,
If we will get ourselves long enough and think peace, we shall become peaceful. Peace is a divine reality at the heart of God. It is an announcement of the presence of God, and God is peace. And from John 14:27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, do I give unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Yet ye believe in God, believe also in me. This is what Jesus was talking about and what Gandhi understood. This is the only thing that will bring peace on earth. We want peace on earth. Let us pray for peace in our own hearts. Let us affirm peace in our own minds. Let us live as though peace were the mandate of God, because it is. And let us, out of the stillness of our own soul, reach back to that ineffable presence, which is peace, and proclaim it even in the midst of confusion. Peace, which is a power at the heart of God.
We're going to get the sound adjusted and have another song.
Letting fear and worry
away from me. I open my eyes and I see there is only love. There is only, oh, there is only love. Love that heals, love that sets me so free. There is only, there is only love. There is only love. There is only love. Love that heals me. Love that sets me so free. There is only. That heals me, love that sets me so free. There is only, there is only love.
Adjusted. How's that?
Fine.
Good. Great. Okay. We've got the hang of it now. Thank you, James. Beautiful song, wasn't it? And now it's time for something else magnificent. Our very own Reverend Maurene. So please give her a big welcome.
Thank you, James. Hope this is not too loud. How's that sound? Okay, today I'm going to be talking about peace. And good morning.
Good morning.
Hope you let the dog out. Okay. Well, yes, today is September 1st, and I keep hearing an echo.
Is the other mic off?
Thank you. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, September 1st. This is usually the time of the year we celebrate Labor Day and, you know, get the kids ready for school, pull out the box of sweaters, get ready for winter. But today I wanted to talk about peace instead of labor. And you might wonder why. Well, we have an election coming in about 2 months. We have a war between Ukraine and Russia, and we have a war with Hamas and Israel. And I feel the tension kind of building. There's some confusion, there's a lot of anxiety, and chaos. There's chaos. So today I want to teach you kind of a technique that I use to come back to peace. Now, you just heard Larry say from Ernest, he said, my peace is found at the heart of God. So why do we cultivate peace? Peace is that inner state of calm. I think peace is heaven on earth. If you're peaceful, you're experiencing that unity with God and everything on this planet. So Ernest also said, peace is always available when we align with God. And we are taught in religious science that we create our own reality, or at least we co-create with others. Do you remember the slogan from the 60s? Be the peace you want to see in the world. I had a cup with that on it. You know, you do make a difference. You are agents for peace. Quantum physics, you know, quantum physics, and I've talked about this before, it teaches us that we create our reality. the science has shown that a wave of possibility will collapse into a particle. We have this ability to change waves to particles and to create a reality. You may also remember Jesus said something about that. He said, as you think, so shall you be. So if we think about peace, we're going to create more peace. And I think we need more right now. First, I always have to have a couple of jokes. So in honor of Labor Day, I'd like to share a story from Matt Kahn, K-A-H-N. He wrote a book called The Universe Always Has a Plan. Well, he said, when I was in kindergarten, we were asked to draw a picture of what we wanted to be when we grew up. Well, I hadn't given it much thought, so I drew the first thing that came to my mind. Apparently, it was so distressing to my teacher that she called my parents. When they arrived, my teacher showed my parents the picture and the pictures of the other kids, and the other kids had pictures of being president and astronaut, and ballerina, nurse, doctor, all these things. She pointed to my picture and said, what do you make of this? Well, so I was called in from recess. Standing before my teacher and parents, I said, well, when I grow up, I want to be the garbage man. Why the garbage man? Well, without even missing a beat, I just looked at them and said, because they only work on Friday. My teacher and parents were doing their best not to laugh. No, Matthew, they only work on Fridays on our street. So I thought about it for a long time and then said, well, forget it. I'll find another work. So, but not to demean anybody, all work is sacred. I'm grateful for the labor of others. I'm grateful for Labor Day, for the celebration, for all the people and animals. So one more. This one is called Rest in Peace. Rest in Peace. A guy was opening a new business and his friend wanted to send him a gift. So he went to the florist and ordered this incredible flower arrangement, even bigger than this. And the friend went to the opening ceremony, looked around for the flowers, and he saw this wonderful wreath with his name on the card, but across the arrangement was a ribbon that said, Rest in Peace. He was understandably confused and a little angry. He left the event and went back to the florist and said, how could you do that? And the florist apologized for the mix-up, and he said, look at it this way. Somewhere in this city, there's a funeral with a wreath that says, good luck in your new location. And just a reminder, if you don't feel peace, Ralph Waldo Emerson said, for every minute of anger, you lose 60 seconds of happiness. So remind yourself. So again, what's peace? Peace is a state of inner calm. Ernest goes on to say, the infinite is always at peace because there's nothing to disturb it. A realization of our oneness with omnipresence brings peace. And that peace is accompanied by a consciousness of power. So think about the power. So when life seems like it's happening to us, and sometimes I feel like, you know, I'm a victim, peace moves us from the feeling of being separate into being one. That's important, because we're never alone. We are not alone. We're all interconnected. Did any of you take English history? If you did, you probably heard about the white and the red, the War of the Roses in England. Well, we've got our own blue and red. You know, and I struggle. I get anxious when I hear people sort of, I use the word awfulizing. You know, isn't this awful? What an awful country. No, no, no. And I have to stop myself. Yes, we learned, we have been learning from war. That's our history. And you may recall famous wars like Civil War, World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Syria. You remember things like Arlington, been there. Punch Bowl, been there. Nagasaki, been there. Hiroshima. You know, these are reminders of hell on earth, not heaven on earth. So I think we've learned all we need to learn about war. It's time to change. It's time to think about peace. Can you imagine, and thank you for the song, can you imagine a world of peace? Can you imagine that? Just, you know, if you imagine, it can be created. We know that. We have that power to create. No poverty, no hunger, no anger, no greed. One people, one planet. Respect for each other. Thank you, John Lennon. Joel Goldsmith, he's the author of a book called The Infinite Way. He said, begin your spiritual life with the understanding that all conflicts must be settled within your consciousness. We must be peace before we pursue peace in the world. Reuben Job, in his book, Praying in a Noisy World, he said, today, how do we intend to hear the heartbeat of God? What will we do to make it possible for us to hear comforting, peace-giving, guiding voice? So I think, well, with TV and cable and text messaging, I'm not sure we can hear God's heartbeat. So once upon a time, we were doing fairy tales last month. So this is just a little. Once upon a time, there lived a king who announced a prize to the artist who could paint the best painting depicting peace. Many great painters sent the king several of their best art pieces. One of the pictures among the various masters was a calm lake mirroring peacefully towering snow-capped mountains with blue sky and fluffy clouds. It was perfect. Most of the people who viewed it thought that was the best one. But when the king announced the winner, everyone was shocked. The picture which won the prize had mountains too, but they were rugged and bare. The sky was angry, there was lightning. They didn't look closely. There was a little bird in a little bush, and she had built her nest in the midst of angry weather. The bird sat on her nest with peace. Peace doesn't mean to be in a place where there's no noise or trouble or chaos. Peace means to be in the midst of all the chaos and still be calm. The real peace is the state of mind, peace of mind, not the state of surroundings. The mother bird at her calm, the mother bird was calm despite her chaotic surroundings. She was indeed the best representation of peace. So, how do we get to peace? I want to share a couple of techniques for growing. I use terms like growing and harvesting because I was raised on a farm in Nebraska. So I think of peace as little ideas or little seedlings. So how do we create these seedlings? Well, when you were a kid, you probably had this technique called stop, drop, and roll. Like if you got too close to the bonfire or something and caught on fire, you stopped, got down on the ground, and you rolled and smothered it out. Well, there's another technique, and it's called stop, drop, and pray. So let me explain that to you. It doesn't put out fires. It puts out chaos and crazy making. So what you do is whatever you're doing, you're starting to feel anxious, you stop, turn away from the condition, turn off the TV, turn off the phone, whatever. You drop from your head to your heart. You pause, you breathe. Don't stop breathing, keep on breathing. And then you pray or do a quick affirmation. A prayer can be something as short as, thank you for peace. I am peace. We said that with lighting the candles. I am peace. Just say that. I am peace. That's enough. So just to give you an example, my daughter texted me pictures of children who were dead or wounded. And she was angry and looking for blame and responsibility and judging and condemning. And, you know, maybe she, I don't know why she sent them to me. She wanted me to share in her anger. And it was like, okay, cool. Okay, stop. Turn off the phone and the pictures. Turn away. Raymond Charles Barker was always good about that. He said, physically turn away. Just move your body because the rest of you will follow. So turn away from it. And then give peace a chance. Give gratitude. Stay in a consciousness of peace. Find your center. And peace, you know, is that unity with the One. The other thing is, Jesus taught two commandments, love God, love each other. You have to see that you are connected to every person. And what you do is you declare that the good is happening in the situation, that peace is breaking out all over, whatever you want to say to bring yourself to that position of peace and power. Now, another example, like, turn on the cable news, CNN, MSNBC, Fox News, ABC, NBC, whichever one. And I see these two people arguing, and they're getting louder, and they're not even paying attention to what the other person is saying. They're yelling over each other. And it's like, what? And I was like, oh, chaos. And at that time, I was thinking, I remembered a Native American saying. The Native American saying is, be tolerant of those who are lost on their path. Ignorance, conceit, anger, jealousy, greed, they stem from a lost soul. So, turn off the TV, turn away from it, or turn it down, and you can turn it down and watch these people. Then they become kind of silly. Drop from your head to your heart. Bless them on their path. Realize ignorance is turned to intelligence. You know, there's only one God. It's all God. It's all spirit. God in amazing disguise. You know, I mentioned this before. When I worked for Mother Teresa, she used to say, this is the person you're caring for. That's God in an amazing disguise. And she also said, if we have no peace, it's because we have forgotten that we belong to each other. I like that one. We belong to each other. So I usually pray, you know, I'm at peace. I allow peace to be in my heart, the peace that passes understanding. And what I mean by passes understanding, don't think about it. You don't think about peace. Peace is here. So peace that passes understanding, right here. Our founder, Dr. Ernest Holmes, wrote these affirmations. He said, I'm surrounded by peace. I'm immersed in peace. There's nothing but peace. Peace, deep, calm, undisturbed. In the morning when I wake up, and you can do this too. You can plant a seedling for peace. You can just wake up and say, the peace of God is my peace now. I'm at peace. I start my day fresh. I see peace in full bloom everywhere I look. So be the peace you want to see in the world. Some of you may have heard of Desmond Tutu. He was the South African Anglican Anglican bishop and theologian. He won a Nobel Peace Prize in 1983 for nonviolent opposition to apartheid in South Africa. Now he said, do your little bit of good where you are. It's those little bits of good put together that overwhelm the world. It's kind of like little pieces, little seedlings that come in to create peace, a bigger peace. And did you know what's behind the Nobel Peace Prize? Well, there was a man, his name was Alfred Nobel, and when he passed, he wrote a will, and the will said, a peace prize should be awarded to the person who in the preceding year shall have done the most or the best work for fraternity between nations, for the abolition or reduction of standing armies, for the holding and promotion of peace congresses. You know, he invented dynamite. He invented something else, ballastite, both of which were used very violently during his lifetime. And he was also into developing armaments. But I think he had a change of heart. There was also a story that when his brother died, they accidentally thought he had died, and they put out a newspaper obituary that said, the merchant of death is dead. Dr. Alfred Nobel, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died. Well, I think after seeing that, he had his wake-up call, and he decided to give his money toward peace. Again, we've learned all we need to know from war. It's time to learn from peace. Also, an interesting backstory. He was from Sweden, and this happened in Sweden, but he went to Norway to present the award because at the time, the Norwegian parliament was closely involved in efforts to resolve conflicts through mediation and arbitration. So another way, in addition to stop, drop, and pray, is forgiveness. And I have a little story here about Gandhi. We're talking about Gandhi today a lot. A fellow named Mark Nepo, you may have heard of him, he wrote the book of Awakening. He said, during one of Mahatma Gandhi's hunger strikes, a man whose daughter had been killed came to Gandhi in a state of anguish. He told Gandhi that he could stop fighting if Gandhi would end his strike and eat. But Gandhi knew the healing was deeper than that, stopping the violence, than just stopping it. He told the man he would eat only when the father embraced the man who killed his daughter. The man collapsed in tears, but he did what Gandhi asked, and the larger conflict ended. Gandhi's request reveals the irrefutable wisdom that only when the broken are healed, no matter what they've done, will we as a people be healed. So we each have to forgive ourselves, and we have to forgive each other. You know, peace cannot move through us if there's a blockage. The Buddha said, when the inner conflict ends, peace begins. Some other spiritual techniques, I know you already know, meditation. Some of you came this morning, thank you. Reading positive messages, doing prayer for other people, and hearing the still small voice. It's an interesting one that I also found about peace. I found this in the New Testament, that Jesus said, when you come to somebody's house, when you first step up into the house, say, peace to this house. What if you went to a meeting and you just walked in and said, peace to this meeting? You went over a friend's house, or you went to an office and you said, peace to this office. You know, it's really easy. It's very easy to plant that little seedling of peace. And I have a quote here from Mark Twain. He's one of my favorite writers. He said, anger is an acid that can do more harm to the vessel in which it is stored than to anything in which it is poured. So true. So, no, you can make a difference. Because we're one, we are interconnected, we have the ability to make changes, we can bring peace. We can bring peace. So, just by being peace, just by being peace. So remember, stop, turn away from it, drop from your head to your heart and breathe, breathe in your heart and pray. So each little seedling grows, and I can imagine. And so it is. Thank you.
So me, when trouble come and my heart burden be, then I am still as I wait here in the silence. Oh, Spirit, come and pray a while with me. You raise me up. Stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas, and I am strong when I am on your shoulders.
Thank you, James. Great, thank you. Well, it's time for our conscious giving and group song. So if you'd like to take your gift in your hand and just know with me, this gift is prosperity going forth out to the world and comes back to me multiplied. I am so blessed for all the gifts, and I allow these gifts to bless others. I'm grateful to Carlsbad Center for Spiritual Living for creating a space. So it is. So let's sing a cappella. I am so blessed.
I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so blessed. One more time. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so blessed.
Thank you all. And we're just handing out a final prayer treatment. I wanted to read, all of us to read this out loud. This is a prayer for world peace by Ernest Holmes. And I thought it would be appropriate for us to really understand better what he had in mind. So did everybody get theirs?
Yes.
Okay. Just go ahead and join me. I know there is but one mind, which is the mind of God, in which all people live and move and have their being. I know there is a divine pattern for humanity, and within this pattern, there is an infinite harmony and peace, cooperation, unity, and mutual helpfulness. I know that the mind of each person, being one with the mind of God, shall discover the method, the way, and the means best fitted to permit the flow of divine love between individuals and nations. I know there shall be a free interchange of ideas, of cultures, of spiritual concepts, of ethics, of educational systems, and scientific discoveries, for all good belongs to all alike. I know that because the divine mind has created us all, we are bound together, one infinite, perfect unity. In bringing about world peace, I know that all people and all nations will remain individual, but unified for the common purpose of promoting peace, happiness, harmony, and prosperity. I know that deep within each person, the divine pattern of perfect peace is already implemented. I know that in each person and leaders of thought everywhere, this divine pattern moves into action and form to the end that all nations, all people shall live together in peace, harmony, and prosperity forever. So it is. So it is. So we're going to stand for closing song, a different closing song, since James is here. It's, are we going to do Blessed Always?
Yes.
Here we go.
God bless.